Hey guys, what's going on? I hope everyone's had a happy and healthy new year and all those other, you know, good salutations and whatnot. I apologize for being really late on the video here. Obviously the Bills have hired Sean McDermott as their head coach, and that came about a month ago as far as, you know, the timeline goes. But I kind of wanted to see a couple other dominoes fall, some assistant coaches, and I was hoping maybe for some clarity on the quarterback situation, which obviously I will touch on, and which obviously we have gotten none of. But, like I said, I apologize for, I guess you could call it tardiness, but I just sort of wanted, like I said, other dominoes to fall. As you obviously know by now, the Bills have hired Sean McDermott as the next head coach. And my immediate reaction was, okay. I hate to sound like I'm indifferent towards it, but aren't you almost reaching that point? Almost reaching that point? You're just like, all right, let's try this guy. We need to make the playoffs. We need to just get this thing back on the rails here. Yeah, okay, Sean McDermott. Yes, let's go. And then he had his press conference, and I liked him. He seemed like a tough dude. A no-nonsense type of guy, and that's sort of what the players have been clamoring for. At least, you know, McCoy and Watkins towards the end of the season were like, yeah, like, discipline, holding guys accountable and whatnot. Like, okay, this looks like the kind of coach that's going to do that. And you're hearing good things from Carolina's defensive players who, you know, he's been the defensive coordinator there for the past six seasons. Thomas Davis is complimenting it, a couple other guys. This is encouraging to hear. It's encouraging to hear a lot of the out-of-towners sort of complimenting the hire. That's sort of what made me feel encouraged. Like, not necessarily just players, but even media members, which, you know, everyone has a different opinion on different media members and whatnot. But I feel like when Rex was hired, they were like, wow, look at you, Bills. You hired Rex Ryan. Good job. Great job. And they gave you this. And then they were like, okay, thanks. And then, like, we turned around and they were like, oh my god, can you believe that? The Bills just hired Rex Ryan. Morons. And then we turned back around and they were like, great job. That's just sort of how it felt to me. Maybe you guys felt differently. I got the Rex Ryan hire. I got it. After 15 years of not making the playoffs, like, the coach quits. The quarterback retires. And we're like, so they needed to sell tickets. So they hire Rex Ryan and they sell 60,000 season tickets. Bang. Done. But now, you know, that type of coach, we've tried every type of coach. What type of coach haven't we tried over the past 17 years? I don't know. I guess the new young offensive guy, I don't know, was that Mike Mularkey? I don't know. I feel like we just tried a bunch of different things, and none of them just throwing stuff at the wall and nothing sticking. My favorite things that I heard or read would be from Del Reed, the Bills Mafia guy, the 26 shirts guy. Great follow on Twitter. Great humanitarian person, obviously. He said, replying to my tweet, I guess, said that he thinks the Bills need to worry about steak and not sizzle. And I think that's a pretty good metaphor. Because let's just be good at football. Let's not be good at press conferences and media relations and stuff. Like, this is a football team, and let's be good at the sport of football. And I'm definitely on board with that. As far as McDermott goes, like I said, he's been the defensive coordinator in Carolina for the past six seasons. He was a DC for the Eagles for two seasons prior to that, and he was with the Eagles for many years. He came up with the Eagles when he was 25 years old in 1999 as a scouting coordinator and, you know, worked his way up the ranks. And now he's 42 years old, finally got his head coaching job. There's a guy who's just patiently waited for his turn and finally got it, so I'm obviously happy for him there. He worked under Jim Johnson, who's, you know, believed to be one of the better defensive coordinators of all time. And subsequently under Andy Reid, who was the head coach. He's worked under Ron Rivera. He's been to Super Bowl. You know, like you said, he knows what that smells like and tastes like, and I like that experience. Obviously like that experience. What does he bring other than his attitude, like on the field? Carolina's been pretty good on defense over the past, you know, couple of years. They were not so great last year. They finished 26th, but I think they had, like three rookies in the secondary or something like that. They lost Josh Norman. Luke Kuechly got that concussion. It sounds like I'm making excuses. I know every team has injuries, but I still think he did a pretty good job with that. They were still fourth in the league in interceptions or something like that. Like, teams do on a lot, but... And I think over his time, I can't remember the exact stat, and I should have looked it up. Over his time in Carolina, over the last four seasons maybe, I don't know if it was all six, they forced the most turnovers, Carolina's defense. I like that. I like to force turnovers. Bills couldn't force turnovers at all last year. That was one of their main problems. When they did, good things happened, like the pick six against the Rams and, like, you know, the fumble return against the Jets, even though they ended up losing that game in week two with the home opener. But good things happen when they force turnovers, but they just never really did. They got three interceptions against the Steelers, but the offense was off. You know, as far as yardage goes, like yards allowed, he took over Carolina's defense in 2011, and they were 28th. They weren't very good. Next year they were 10th. The next year they were 2nd. The next year they were back to 10th. You can expect some sort of regression there somewhere, I guess. And the year after that, 10th, 2nd, 10th, then 6th. In 2015, they went to the Super Bowl. And then, I might have said 26 earlier, they were 26th in points allowed. They were 21st last season in total yards. They've been pretty good against the run. They have finished top 10 three of the last 4 years, despite the fact they weren't that good on defense last year. Like, I'm encouraged here. They, against the pass, they were 24th when he took over, then 13th, then 6th, then 11th, then 11th, and then, like I said, they put a bunch of rookies out there last year. They lost Tillman and Norman, obviously, and they were 29th. Now, I don't know what the Bills are going to do specifically with their defense, but I think you're going to see more of a 4-3 look, other than the 3-4. Like, the NFL goes through these phases, which is funny. It's like 4-3. It's like you beat people up with the 4-3, and then the 3-4, you're faster. You rush the passer and all that stuff. Now it's kind of regressing back to the, not regressing necessarily, but going back to the 4-3. I think that's the better look, at least for the Bills, for Jerry Hughes and for Kyle Williams and Marcel Darius in the middle. You know, and then Shaq Lawson handing the dirt defensive end, hopefully. Not sure he's going to play linebacker. Not sure what they're going to do with Gilmore at corner. Obviously, they'd probably like to keep him. They'd like to keep Zach Brown. They'll get Reggie Ragland back. Like, these are all encouraging things. McDermott hires Leslie Frazier to be his defensive coordinator, who... No, there's kind of a mixed thing on him, too. He got kind of some weird numbers that I was looking up. His defense is... When he can focus purely on defense, he took over Cincinnati in 2003. They were 28th overall in defense. Next year, they were 19th. Next year, he moved on to the Colts, coach defensive backs. And he found himself in Minnesota in 2007. And they were 20th in defense. And next year, they were 6th. Next year, they were 6th. And next year, they were 8th. Then he became the head coach. And they fell to 21st and 16th and 31st. Like, when he's focusing purely on defense, he's doing okay. He took over Tampa in 2014 defensively. 25th. Next year he was there, they were 10th. Like, you're seeing these improvements. Now, I think it might be largely McDermott's defense. So, and Frazier's there, don't get me wrong. The number one thing that McDermott looked for in most of his assistants was experience. And Leslie Frazier has the experience. And, you know, that goes a long way. I think that players respect people who have been in the league for a long time. Leslie Frazier played in the league. Like, that'll help. And I like that direction defensively. Because let's face it, we think, most of us, that the defense was the reason last year. Like, if the defense kept us I know that there were times where Tyrod, needed a player here or there, but we thought the defense was going to be better. It wasn't, and it cost him a lot of games. Offensively, Rick Dennison going to be the OC. Now, he has basically been Gary Kubiak's right-hand man for a couple of years now, for more than a couple of years, for about 10 years. He was in Denver with him, in Houston with him, and then back in Denver with him. Their offenses have been a mixed bag. They were actually pretty good in Houston. The first year he was there, they were 3rd and 13th, 7th and 11th. Like, those are good numbers. 16th in 2015 with Manning at his worst and Osweiler, and then 27th last year with Trevor Siemian. So I guess that's to be expected. You know, they have this reputation for being this bootleg type of offense, and maybe that plays in the favor of Tyrod. We don't know what they're going to do with Tyrod. I'm going to talk about that a little bit right now, I guess. It's just, Dennison was in, obviously in Denver, the year Tyrod became the free agent and the Bills signed him, and he chose the Bills over Denver, but Denver wanted him. So this might make sense for them to keep him. But at the same time, I don't know if, I like Tyrod so much. I think he's got respective players, but it's, and everyone likes, I like, how can you not like him? He's so likable. He's so versatile. He can throw the ball a mile, but he leaves plays out on the field. Like, his numbers look good, but it could be so much better just because of the plays he leaves out on the field. And if you're Terry Pegula or Doug Whaley or even Sean McDermott, if you go back and watch all those games and you're like, or let's just, like, for example, say Oakland, you're watching Derek Carr just whap, 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 and they're blowing you out all of a sudden after trailing by 15, you'd be like, I gotta get better at the position than this. You're looking at Aaron Rodgers in the playoffs this year. You're looking at Tom Brady in the Super Bowl. Tom Brady is the exception to everything. I get it. Aaron Rodgers is also kind of an exception. But, like, look at Matt Ryan, won MVP. Look at, like, you can't really look at Tyrod and be like, yeah, we can win a Super Bowl with him. Like, do you want to keep him? Yeah, he's the best you've had since Jim Kelly. I get that. But, like, should that be the benchmark? Shouldn't you want to win a Super Bowl? Shouldn't you be like, I like Tyrod Taylor. This is a good guy. But I clearly can't win a Super Bowl with him. Because look at these guys that are in the playoffs. Just firing missiles, throwing darts. So I get it. It's okay. And I'm not going to criticize them for getting rid of him. Really not. I wouldn't criticize them. I would criticize them probably for starting Cardale Jones, because that would feel, you've told me you think you're close, and that makes me not believe you. If you take Deshaun Watson or Trubisky or Kaiser in the draft and play him, I get it. That's fine. I'm not going to criticize you for doing that. Stick your neck out there for somebody and play him and do it. Whether it's, you know, I don't really want to see like a retread veteran unless it's Tony Romo. If the Bills can get Tony Romo, they'll sell tickets, obviously. They'll be better on the field, like, instantly. Think about the teams that the Bills have to play next year. Brady twice, the Falcons and Matt Ryan, the Panthers and Cam Newton, the Saints and Drew Brees, the Colts and Andrew Luck, and, like, Philip Rivers, even though the Chargers were bad. Like, we play good quarterbacks next year. Is Tyrod Taylor going to be zipping it around with these guys? Probably not. Tony Romo could. And I think they really need to explore that option if he becomes available. And it looks like he's going to become available. That, like, ooh, he gets hurt all the time. So I know. But that, he's a thrower. You need a thrower. Tyrod Taylor can throw the ball super far. But what have you seen to make you think he's going to be any better than he already is? You got him. You've seen 29 games of him, and, like, that's it. Like, the last game he played against Miami, that was your outlier. And now you're sitting there like, can he do that all the time? I don't know. Probably not. But, like, it's just such a close call. If they kept Tyrod, I don't think I'd even criticize him, honestly. I know I just made an entire case against him, but I don't think I'd criticize them for keeping him. Because it's hard to find competent players at that position. And Tyrod is competent at it and will probably get a job somewhere else if the Bills let him go. And the Bills might look stupid for letting him go. Unless they bring in, like, Romo or something, or draft Watson at 10. Like, they just have to have a plan. And I don't want the plan to be, like, oh, we'll play Cardale Jones and maybe get a top pick next year. Like, or we'll sign Nick Foles and we'll see what happens. That's not a plan to me. Like, that's not... I just talked about getting better at football. That's not getting better at football. That is staying in, like, a stagnant position. And I'm not about that. I think the team is good. Maybe I'm totally blind to this. Maybe I'm just insane. I think the team is good. They have a great running back. They have a great receiver. They have a pretty darn good tight end who's a matchup problem for anybody. If they were to get, like, a Tony Romo, hypothetically, they could use the first-round pick on, like, Mike Williams or Corey Davis. Like, whew. They have good offensive linemen. They need a right tackle, probably, but they're pretty good up front. Like, this offense could be rolling next year if they get somebody who's competent to play quarterback. And Tyrod is competent. I agree. But if you can get a real thrower, game changer. We're in the mix. Playoffs. With Tony Romo, we are. If Deshaun Watson's as good as Dabo Swinney thinks he is, like Michael Jordan, they could be. I like Deshaun Watson. He can clearly, like, he can throw the ball. He can run, don't get me wrong, but that dude can throw, too. That's why I was hoping to have some sort of clarity on it. This, as I started this video, because I knew I'd ramble on it, and, you know, thank you. I want to know what you guys are thinking. Like, keep me in the loop with what you're thinking. I do the same on Twitter. Follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is the same as my YouTube username. And I talk to just about everybody who doesn't propose really, really dumb things, which does happen, obviously, because it's Twitter. Let me know what you're thinking, guys. That's the bottom line. I want to hear ideas and stuff, and I'm trying to give you some with, you know, Watson or Romo, or I don't know if I'm sold on Trubisky, but, like, if they pick him, that's fine. Just get a player and, like, play him. Stick your neck out, like I said, stick your neck out there from somebody and play them. Let's see. I'll probably make another video when, right around draft time, when there's more clarity on the quarterback and whatnot. But until then, guys, enjoy your winter, I suppose. But above all else, go Bills.